Hello. Aloha. Okay, so I think we have some people online. Are the online people ready to go? Everyone is ready to go, good. Is my hair a mess? My wife would be upset since it's on camera. It's all right? What? It's the Einstein look. Old age. Okay. So, and you have that up there. Oh, you can't read it very well, except at the top. You can't lift that up, no. Okay. So now we're, hello everybody. So now we're going to the Mahayana. We've been reading in the Theravada literature from the Pali for three times, and we talked also about Buddhist science. And so Leslie Williams not coming tonight? He's too busy. He's in New Haven, right? Yeah. And, well, that's okay. It's better that he's busy. And so now we're moving to Mahayana and to what I call non-dual Buddhism instead of dualistic Buddhism. And I think I mentioned to you all already that the usual description of how the Mahayana emerged is very rude, typical the way Western scholars study Buddhism. They really started out from the British, you know, who were colonial in India. And they, although it's to be handed to the British that they're the ones who found all the monuments in India. The, you know, the Mughals and people had dismantled them and they had used like amazing carved sculptures and things to form bridge abutments and rivers and things. They were just completely, because of the whole Muslim thing about they don't like iconic figures or human beings, you know, they think there's idolatry if you have a such representation. You know, they have only geometric things, you know, and plants and flowers. So that was part of it. And then part of it, for some reason, they just erased it, the Buddhist presence. So by the time the British were there in the 19th century, had sort of took over India, they would ask these Brahmin Sanskrit scholars, like, who was Buddha? And no one could tell them. They didn't know who Buddha was. And they said, well, he's God, I think. Because they have this idea that Buddha is the ninth incarnation of Vishnu. Because they know that Buddha had a big impact. And so they said, Buddha's God. They don't really know the story of Buddha. So until 1837, the British thought Buddha was an African who came to Sri Lanka. Because there are those sculptures of Buddha with little curly things, like little snails on his head. So they thought he had like curly hair, you know, and that he was African, and that he was just somebody that existed in Ceylon, in Sri Lanka, seriously. And then they finally figured out, oh, he was this Prince Siddhartha, and then they found some text in Nepal with his life story, and they finally figured out who was Buddha, and then they found Bodh Gaya, which was under a mountain of sand. You know, they started doing archaeology and they found all these Buddhist monuments throughout India. And so that's good. But the British had a fixation that everywhere they conquered had to be going downhill when they got there. So it was better in the ancient time and worse in the later time. And that justified their conquering and, you know, making, you know, stiff upper lip and all that, you know, making them all Brits, you know. And the way they used that in the case of Buddhism was that, well, Buddha was a good guy. He was sort of like Socrates. He had dialogues with people. He wandered around in a toga. It was orange toga, but never mind. You know, like not a white toga like Socrates. And, you know, he was a rationalist and he didn't believe in God and all this kind of thing, you know. So they kind of liked him. He was almost like a Protestant. But then they said, well, then there were too many monks, and Protestants don't like monks. So then the monks became very unpopular after a while in India. So then Hinduism was getting very popular, and Bhakti and Vishnu and Shiva, people were getting to like that, and goddesses, because those Hindus just had to have all those polytheistic gods and goddesses, you know. So then Buddhism decided we better compete with Hinduism, so then they made up all this stuff called the Mahayana. And they made Buddha into a god. And therefore a degeneration of the good old clean Socrates Buddha, you know, to turn him into some sort of supernatural being. And then about 500 years after that, suddenly you have Tantra, you know, and you have fierce deity statues, fierce Buddhas, you have female Buddhas, you have male-female union, Buddha, really freaked out the Victorians. So it really, so then Buddhism was like a symbol of India, and then naturally, since it, you know, sex and violence emerged with the tantras, then Buddhism was worthless. It had dissolved into some sort of notion of the native, you know, like undisciplined passions of native people. And so naturally the Muslims came and conquered them, because at least they're warriors, but then, you know, the Christians had a big crusade thing against the Muslims. So then that's even worse. So then finally we arrived, the British, you know, with civilization, you know, and we, you know, we built the capital in New Delhi, and we unified all of them, and they all speak English, you know, because otherwise they have hundreds of languages in India. And we made one nation out of India, you know, and it was the jewel in the crown for the Raj, you know. They had, so there's a legend that everything is worse. That's later, you see, and the earlier thing is better. It also is the same with people who collect antiquities. You know, like a painting from the 19th century, even if it's the most brilliant painting ever, is less valuable than some horrible old scrap from the 13th century. You know, they, or they're into that. They, you know, they have that kind of attitude. So, so their very rude idea is that the Mahayana is just a fake thing made up by some later people who pretended that Buddha taught it, but actually they wrote it themselves, and they did it in order to compete with the sort of colorful religion of Hinduism and make Buddhism into more of a religion, that's, which is very rude, you know. Nagarjuna, for example, the man who is credited of having discovered the library of the Mahayana Sanskrit texts, you know, the, like the Vimalakirti Sutra and others, he is, he also wrote very important philosophical works that have survived to this day, translated into a numbers of many languages, and very powerful philosophical writer. He was extremely, maybe one of the world's, maybe the world's greatest philosopher after Buddha, maybe. And yet he forged some sutras. Because, you know, Indian people didn't know any better, according to the British, do you understand? It's like they don't know any better. They don't know their own history. They don't take care of, they don't keep records, all this kind of thing. Sort of racist attitudes that the British had. And they're still in the scholarship. Whereas the Buddhists say that the Buddha, and I've had this conversation with you before, the Buddha had a higher consciousness. Hi, are you joining us? You don't, it's optional, you don't have to, if you were looking for something else. Oh, I see, you're a friend of Charlie and Pauline, oh, how nice. So the, oh, you're the son?
No, I'm their
daughter. Oh, the daughter, oh, son-in-law, oh, very nice. This is nice family visiting from Taiwan, from Dallas, Texas, and Taiwan. So, so Buddha had a higher consciousness, and that consciousness was aware of the trends of history, and he purposely did not teach broadly the Mahayana, because the Mahayana is more overwhelming, and it would have been misunderstood at the, in his day. He felt he taught some of his own close disciples, and then he said, "Keep these texts to yourselves and just preserve them in some library, and in around 400 years someone with Naga in his name will be born who will be a great scholar, and then he will spread the knowledge of these texts." That's what he said. And the Western people just can't imagine that somebody would be that, have such a vision of history, you know. They can't even predict the outcome of an election in 43 days. So how would anybody know what's going to happen in 400 years? There couldn't be such a higher consciousness, in other words, like a supercomputer human, like namely Buddha. But that was the case. And it's logical. If you think about it logically, here's the thing. You yourself have an awakening. You have an experience. And you feel that reality is blissful. The true nature of reality is nirvana, even. And you announce that to people. You can, third noble truth. That's what I discovered. Peaceful, fabulous, it's just clear light, no problem. And all the problems come from not knowing that, from ignorance, right? But those are not real, but they're less real, those problems, than the solution, which is nirvana, which is right here. He announced that right away. But he makes it, it lets people think, well, I'm suffering. I have a pain in my foot, I have arthritis, I'm old, whatever. I lost my girlfriend or my boyfriend or my child or my somebody. I had an accident. So how can this be nirvana? That's what people will think, right? So he says, well, it's just because you don't know the nature of what it is what he's saying. So then they think, oh, okay, he discovered that this here is unreal, really, and that there's some place which is really heaven, like heaven, or better than heaven, actually, because they had a lot of heavens in India of those days. They had the visions of heaven. But even better, it's like beyond even heaven. So they naturally are going to think it's somewhere else. Do you follow? Because it couldn't possibly be this. So Mahayana says, actually, right here, you're in nirvana. It's all fine right now. Oh, you don't feel that way? Because you're confused. So you have to straighten out that confusion. And then you don't have to die. You don't have to go away somewhere. You don't have to be obliterated. You can understand it. If you understood what you really are, what every cell in your body is, what the cell and the floor and the building and the cosmos and the planets and the stars, if you understood it, you would feel blissfully free from suffering, no matter what. And you'd still be here. That's a little hard to get, isn't it? It's very overwhelming. Like, whoops, here it is. You know, which is already there, even in the dualistic teaching of samsara and nirvana as two things. But it's not pressing it so well. And then another way, so one way of two ways of misunderstanding that would be, one would be that, oh, well, okay, if it's nirvana, then I can just do whatever I feel like, and it doesn't matter what I do. So if I can I can rob a bank, or I can kill some people and take their things, or whatever, you know, abuse anybody, do whatever I feel like. And it's all still nirvana, so nobody's really hurt, they just don't know, so I can be harmful to people. So that's a kind of excuse to behave badly. And actually, you already had that excuse existing in India of his time under the Brahminical caste theory, the Vedic caste theory, that all of everything was the body of God, and if you were an underling, you were the feet of God, and so you should just, you know, work in the fields or clean the latrine or do whatever the lowly people do, and you're still fine because you're part of God. So there's a kind of, it's all one sort of thing, legitimizing letting some people have a bad situation, and then some people sitting on top of them in a higher caste, you know. So it could also be understood as legitimizing that. Or then the final thing that would be harmful to someone is they would think, well, this guy's ridiculous, you know. There's no way I'm going to think this is bliss, this here, I'm suffering. So he's just wrong. You know, and then they would feel there was no path to achieve freedom from suffering. They would feel that way. Oh, good, there's the yogini. Very good. Okay, so he knew that. So he wanted to create a space and a cultural development. And the way he did that was he created these free places, the Buddhist mendicant monastic community, where people could get a lifelong scholarship. Just by saying they were, you know, shaving their head, putting on a robe, and saying, I'm looking for nirvana, I want to study Buddha's teaching, I take refuge in Buddha Dharma Sangha, I don't want to pay taxes, I don't want to work, I don't want to raise a family, I don't want to have children, I don't want to do any of that, I want the highest bliss of nirvana, and I want lunch, free lunch, from everybody for a lifetime. And I don't ask for supper, I don't ask for breakfast, just lunch. And whatever it is, I'm not fussy, I'll take whatever you give. But I want that forever. And India was so generous because they were richer than China, they were richer than Iran, they were richer than Mesopotamia, they were richer than the Nile. India was the richest place. That's why Buddha went there. He didn't go there because it was a poor country, he went there because it was a rich country. And they had a food surplus, and they didn't have good ice boxes. So they might as well give it away. It was easier for them to give it away. And the kings also didn't have, they were very wealthy anyway. You know, they would give their weight in diamonds, remember, in the fabulous wealth of Indian kings. And it was like that ancient time. And so they didn't mind some idle people. In fact, it kept them out of trouble. You know, some people just sitting around meditating, it's better than having a revolution all the time or something, you know. So it had a use for the king. Okay? So therefore, he created those institutions. And it was like a free school for people, and people did a lot of learning, women and men, and they elevated the level of science and understanding and medicine and everything in the society. The Buddhist monks knew medicine, and they would also treat people of lower caste, or, you know, fine, they didn't, they weren't like the Brahmins who only treated themselves, you know. And so it had a very big impact on Indian society over 400 years. And Max Weber, the great German sociologist, completely misunderstood that point. He thought, because he was a Protestant, right, from North Europe, and he thought the Protestant ethic was really great because everybody worked all the time. And he thought, like Protestants do, that monasteries are useless. They're places for slackers to hide out and eat food, like the communists say, you know, just parasites, you know, they're no good. And Protestants subliminally think that. They think that monks are, you know, just corrupt, and they're all like Friar Tuck, and they're drinking wine and getting drunk and getting fat. That's what they think. And they don't think that there are people who are seeking a higher way of being and a higher understanding. Right? So Max Weber missed that. He thought that the Buddhists had no impact on society. But he had a theory like that. But it's so wrong. Try to start an institution right now in New York City. Go to Mayor de Blasio and say, every restaurant in New York should give a free lunch to anybody who is homeless, who is sincerely seeking truth. They're not just begging, or they're not on crack. They're seeking truth. And anybody who's sincerely doing that and has like stamp of approval that they're really doing that should have free food and a free, safe place to stay. Ask Mayor de Blasio. It's not going to be giving that. They, you know, the actual homeless people there in dangerous places, they're on the street freezing to death. They won't give that. Right? They're even freaking out about welfare queens and whatever, so they're not going to give it. But they did in India. And so, therefore, after 400 years of that, the society had a generosity and had a willingness to, and a level of learning and teaching that was very strong. So then, the Nagarjuna and Asanga and various great masters brought out the Sanskrit teachings of the recordings of the teachings of Buddha and blew people away. With that, and contrary to what the Westerners think, they were monks themselves, and they supported the monasteries more strongly than ever, and the monasteries became universities. So it was a progressive thing. The Mahayana was a progress in Indian society, and now they were using the monks are the faculty of the universities, and that's a really smart thing, because they don't have families, so they don't need big salaries. All they need is free lunch to be the faculty. I never tell that to college administrators and university administrators. I never give that analysis, because then they would start reducing everybody's salary except for themselves. You're here for teaching, you're here to seek truth, you're a researcher, so you don't need a salary, you know. But monks are really cheap, you know. If they're all monks and nuns, they don't need a lot of things, you know, for the administration. So, okay, so then we have Mahayana. Now, look how overwhelming. Here we start with the Vimalakirti Sutra. Hello. Come on. There you are. Why is it like that? Now we're going to look at the Vimalakirti. Now, Vimalakirti Sutra is a particularly marvelous one, not only because I translated it, but also because I would improve it today if I did it again. Those of you online, you had the Vimalakirti, a e-text of it that we made available to you, and I hope you read some. And this is a scan, and there's some typos. And thus did I hear on a certain occasion, is what I would translate the beginning. I never say, but I think I already told you that, I don't say thus have I heard at one time the Buddha, you know. But at least I said thus have I heard at one time. And I already explained that to you, right, how that's the warrant that this was from the Buddha's mouth, you know. It's not just, it's not once upon a time. It's like, I heard this, and I heard it from Buddha. So that's what I'm telling the sutra, right? So the Lord Buddha was in residence in the garden of Amrapali, in the city of Vaishali, attended by a great gathering of bhikshu mendicants. There were 8,000, and they were all arhats, they were all saints. They were free from impurities and afflictions, and all had attained self-mastery. Their minds were entirely liberated by perfect knowledge. They were calm and dignified like royal elephants. They had accomplished their work, done what they had to do, cast off their burdens, attained their goals, and totally destroyed the bonds of existence. That's ignorance-driven existence. They all had attained the utmost perfection of every form of mind control. Then of bodhisattvas, who may or may not be monks or may or may not be arhats, but they are seekers of Buddha, Buddhahood. They are, you know, seeking enlightenment, full enlightenment, not just arhatship. There were 32,000, a really huge assembly, great spiritual heroes. Also, Mahayana is a science fictional world it delivers also, which is very hard to imagine. For example, life on other planets or in other worlds is completely normal in Mahayana, ancient Mahayana Indian Buddhism. That there's like billions of humanoid planets like this is a normal idea, and that there are highly advanced beings, the bodhisattvas, who can travel between them, and they don't need a big spaceship like in Close Encounters of the Third Kind, you know, like a metal thing. They just travel with subtle body by mind. They can just shoot like the speed of thought, faster than light, instantaneous travel across, you know, warp drive. They have total warp speed travel, those bodhisattvas. And this is an ancient thing. I don't think people could even begin to get a grasp of it if we hadn't had 50 years of Star Trek. But that's what was normal in the Indian imagination. I'm not saying, I don't know, I didn't see anybody show up from another planet that I knew, that I recognized. So I'm not saying that I personally experienced that, but I'm just saying the imaginative world of ancient India of this time, this is normal. They wouldn't say such a thing was supernatural. They would say it was super normal. So therefore, around the Buddha, there are bodhisattvas from other worlds. They always go wherever a Buddha is teaching on whichever planet. And that accounts for the 32,000. You know. Although also Buddha had a special property. If Buddha, you know, he didn't have microphones and like a rock and roll thing with big speakers up on a tower, you know. But when Buddha talked to thousands of people, each one saw him as being right in front of them. He had some sort of special power like that, like multi-electronic presence. And also, if they didn't know the language, the main language of that area, they heard his speech in whatever their own language was. These are the special qualities, abilities of a Buddha. So it's a super normal type of being, Buddhahood. To attain Buddha is to become something a little different from an ordinary human, from having been an ordinary human, and different from an ordinary god also, but having in previous lives been gods, but in this life human. And it's something special. They can be many bodies at once. Many of the Indian gods, they believe, can do like that. They can manifest that way in different ways. And even the Western god did that. The Western god spoke to Moses as a bush, not member of the bush family, just an actual bush. Although I always thought of that incident when Jesse Jackson years ago said, better to stay out of the bushes, which we failed to do in that particular election. That was the Dukakis election, I think, unfortunately. Anyway, I'm sorry, I shouldn't digress. Watching too many debates. So they also have that's a divine kind of power. Buddhas had that power, you know. They say whatever one needs to be manifested, a Buddha can manifest that to whatever person there is. That's a saying, you know, like normal saying. And that is what a normal Buddhahood is. And every single one of you is going to have that ability. Not just by getting on television, because you just can multiply your because you're a Buddha is a being. You have to remember, a Buddha is a being which is revealed now openly in Mahayana, is a being who, to become a Buddha, you have to have developed an identification where you have identified with all life. So you think you are an infinite universe. You feel that, like I think I'm me, like inside the skin here, and I go, this is me. But if you're Buddha, you can't hit anything because you feel you're everything. At the same time as you feel you're everything, in reacting to individuals who feel isolated and as apart from everything, you can manifest something that looks like one of them to communicate with them. And it doesn't have to be human. Buddha can be a bird, Buddha can be a lion, Buddha can be a deer. A Buddha can be a chair, a Buddha can be a building, a Buddha can be a continent, a planet. This concept of what they call nirmana kaya, the body of emanation of a Buddha, is hugely inconceivable, actually. It's something amazing. But they don't do it out of some, to play around or to be powerful or something. They only, because they don't need to have a specific embodiment, because they are everything, and they feel they are everything as an ocean of bliss. They are sugata, what they call, sukhamgata, one who has become blissful. And so they don't need to have a separated body, but they can't communicate to anybody else. If they are just like an infinite ocean, then how are they going to communicate? And so then they appear separate to some people. In the Vimalakirti, toward the end, because much of the sutra happens in Vimalakirti's house, the Buddha allows Vimalakirti to give much of the teaching. He gives the beginning and the end part of the teaching. And toward the end, Vimalakirti goes to where Buddha is outside of the city, in the suburbs, and he takes the whole group with him, actually, because they said they decided to go and have a visit to Buddha at the end. And then when he comes, Buddha says, well, you all wanted to see the Buddha. Now that you're here, when you see the Buddha, what do you see? And Vimalakirti is standing right in front of Shakyamuni Buddha, and he says, I don't see Buddha when I see a particular embodiment. I don't see Buddha when I hear a certain voice. I don't see Buddha, this and that. He goes on and on, negating everything, meaning that he's acknowledging that Buddha himself feels he is everyone else. You know, like, did I tell you my story about my wife talking about the Dalai Lama miracle? So one gentleman from India asked me once at a luncheon, because I'd known Dalai Lama for 50 years, they said, have you ever seen him do a miracle? So I don't know what to say quite, you know. Some funny things happen, you know, around spiritual people, but I didn't want, you're not supposed to talk about it in Buddhism. So I'm sort of thinking how to answer, you know, in my usual little bit slow manner. And my wife says something. Oh yeah, many times, she says. And I'm like, what is he going to say? No, I'm surprised at myself. So then the guy is leaning in the chair like this. And he says, well, what was it? What was it? She says, well, we have hosted him in many events. We traveled with him and gone to see him in India and everywhere. And I've seen him in many cases in the high stress, with many people wanting part of his time, you know, and a long list of them and crowds of people pushing towards him. And all of that time, I have never seen him not give his full attention to whomever he was having a conversation with, whoever was consulting him. So the guy was so disappointed. He was like, oh, that's a miracle. But that is a miracle. In the sense, because technically, if you were a Buddha yourself, and you might be, you were talking to me, you would be an emanation body only. You would feel you're everything here, all the people here, simultaneously. And if you were talking to me, you would also feel you were me. So it would be sort of like a puppet, you know, one hand talking to the other. But the difference is that your one hand, your Buddha hand, sort of feels great and knows what's going on. And this one is feeling some dissatisfied and discontented and needs to change their ignorant way of seeing to something else. And so technically the Buddha is perfect teacher because knows what the confusion is. Because feels it, from empathetically feels it, what the other person feels. You follow me? So in other words, completely, and people when they meet Dalai Lama, they sometimes cry right away. They have very strong experiences because they are meeting someone, in many cases perhaps for the first time, where it's not this mountain and that mountain, which is a Tibetan expression, you know? You know, like when we meet, I assume you're over there, you know, right? And you meet me like I'm over here. And we kind of reach out. We shake hands, we talk, we listen to each other, right? But, you know, we're in separate places. We're different people. So an enlightened person, fully enlightened person, is both people. So when you meet one, it's like the person is completely one with you. They don't say anything. They don't say, oh, I'm feeling your pain. That politicians say that, like Bill Clinton. But they don't say that. But in fact, that's the way it's defined, you know, in the science, Buddhist science defines it. And don't think it's unrealistic, because you've been in love in your life, and you've had a baby, or and you identified completely with another being, even for a moment. You had such an experience. So a human being, and if you are ever a member of a team, If you were in a war, you identify with your buddies, you know. If you're a really old friend, you feel sort of one with them. You're in the kitchen with your people of your family and you're chopping vegetables and somebody cuts themselves. And everybody goes, oh, like that. And they have identified with the person who is hurt. Because we have the ability to expand our sense of identification, or when we get a bit depressed and paranoid and withdrawn to ourselves, we completely are shut off from feeling anything about any other people, unaware of what they feel. You follow me? So in other words, our identification, and then psychotic people become where they don't even identify with themselves. They are sort of in some other place, you know. So the process of human identification is very programmable, deprogrammable, you know, it's very expandable and contractable. Do you follow me? So in theory, it could be possible for a being who develops that, especially under Buddhist science, where every being has infinite multiple lives, and has already lived a huge number of times. Anybody who's human is so complicated. They've already been every other kind of being. And then they have time to evolve in the no limit of lives. And so that they would develop finally the highest level is where you identify with every being. So then there's no enemy, you know, there's no, everyone is you in a way, you know. Just like, so you feel that way, you know, and that's what a Buddha is, in, by definition, in the Buddhist science, okay? I mean, I don't know if it's true, because I think Dalai Lama is a little in that direction and some other people I've met in my life. I'm not like that yet, but I plan to be, I think I will be. And I believe all of you will also be. But maybe it will be in other lives, in some case. And maybe some of you already are. In which case, I know you don't mind if I don't know that. Okay? So that's the definition. Okay, so Buddha's there with all this huge assembly, right? And they describe at length the attainments of the people in that assembly. And even just to read, I could spend the whole class just reading all the different qualities of the bodhisattvas, who some come from other worlds, you know. They were great spiritual heroes who were universally acclaimed. They were dedicated through the penetrating activity of their great super knowledges and were sustained by the grace of the Buddha, guardians of the city of Dharma. One of the super knowledges is the ability to read minds, you know, to be clairvoyant, know what other people are thinking, you like completely know that. And actually, everybody has that ability. And this is a funny thing in the Tibetan Book of the Dead that I just have to share with you. And it's a thing, that, you know, in other words, describing what happens after death, you know, to people. And one of the things that it says is, after you die, for a while, you hang around where you previously lived, and you're kind of puzzled about your body, and you can't get back into it, but you're around. And you see all the people that you knew, you know, your loved ones, your friends, your enemies, people. But once you're out of the brain, out of the wetware, you know, and you're, you know, old age, you know, Alzheimer's, you know, forgetting everything, you are immediately clairvoyant. You're 9 times more intelligent. You have much more psychic ability in your subtle, like ghost-like form. And so it says, don't be mad with the priest at your funeral. If he's thinking about having a beer and going home and he couldn't care less about what he's reciting. If someone is giving a eulogy, your relative, and then you read in the mind an underlying idea like, oh, good riddance, I'm sick of that Bob, he was always making a problem. And there's an underlying stream of thought like that, like negative thought. Don't be upset with them. Everybody has multiple levels in their minds, you know, complicated minds, you know, human beings. They probably do mean the nice thing they're saying too. So don't get mad, don't be upset, because it's very important in this between death and rebirth condition that you don't emotionally get upset. They have a warning like that. Don't get mad. When Uncle Joe is like, not, he's celebrating because you're dead. Don't get mad. That's it. So everyone has this kind of abilities. We all have a little empathy, you know. That is why human beings are close to enlightenment. That's why Buddha makes such a fuss about human beings. You see, gods are actually more intelligent than human beings. There's lots of gods in the Buddhist world. Small ones, big ones, little ones. You could say angels, but many, even deities. But they are more intelligent, actually, than humans. You know, they could, like, do, like, long division in their head if they bothered. But the problem with them is they're not bothering because they think they have very long lives. They're living in, like, 100-year jacuzzis and things like that. You know, and then they will die because they're still impermanent, fabricated beings made of causes and conditions. But they're sort of so far away, they don't pay attention. You know? Because humans are very vulnerable, and they know how vulnerable they are, and so they realize that things are serious, and they want to, like, be realistic. So humans are very, very capable of strong evolutionary quantum leaps. That's why Buddha taught humans, especially made a special thing about humans. You follow? That's why he was born as a human and showed how humans can become a higher being. You know? So a great description of the Bodhisattva, but you should read it yourself. You know, it's terrific. I want to just give you... So they said, you know, we're one to extol the Bodhisattvas for innumerable hundreds of thousands of myriads of aeons. One could still not exhaust their mighty floods of virtues. So these Bodhisattvas are like angels. They're like incredible beings. You know, they're almost like gods. Some of them are like gods. And then there are many gods in the assembly. 10,000 Brahmas. Brahmas means creator gods for the ordinary Indians, the non-Buddhist Indians. They think Brahma is the creator at this time. And then, but some come from other worlds, you know, they're the top god of other worlds. None of them are omnipotent, of course, in Buddhist view, but they come from there. And they're also there. And there are also many other types of gods from different heavens. And there were dragons and goblins and fairies and titans and birdmen and not centaurs, the opposite of a centaur. Right, a centaur has a horse body and a human head in Greece, but a kinnara has a horse head and a human body, and mahoragas, and mahora, kind of serpent being who talks, you know. And then there was the fourfold community consisting of mendicants, male and female mendicants, and ordained laymen and lay women. So then the Lord Buddha, thus surrounded and venerated by these multitudes of many hundreds of thousands of living beings, sat upon a majestic lion throne and began to teach the Dharma. Dominating all these multitudes, just as Meru, the king of mountains, looms high over the oceans, the Lord Buddha shone, radiated and glittered as he sat upon his magnificent lion throne. So now there's a little bit of a backstory. Now, 500 yuppies come from this very wealthy city, Vaishali, to see the Buddha. And the reason that the young people come is that the elder people are boycotting Buddha temporarily, because the mayor of the city and the grandees, you know, the big shots of the city, had wanted to invite him to stay in the town hall, sort of like for the honored guests, you know, and make a big fuss about him. But Buddha always had the practice when he would come near a city, he would accept the first invitation that was given to him. So they had a horse race with a lady who was she was sort of a courtesan. She was like a fashion designer, she was like a movie star in that, you know, dancer, you know, geisha kind of thing. Her name was Amrapali, and she had a big estate in the suburbs, and she had better horses than the mayor. So she got to the Buddha first. They had this carriage race. And then she said, Buddha, I want you and your 500 monks to stay in my grove, and I built the little huts for you in case it rains, and I have prepared food and so on, and I want you to stay there. And so then Buddha when he doesn't speak, that means he accepts the invitation. So when the mayor got there, it's like, sorry, it's already, they knew that he would accept the first person. So, oh, he's staying with that movie star. We're not going to go study with him this time. We're not going out there, no way. We're not going to her place to listen to him. So they were protesting. But the young people, they come, 500 of them. And each of them has a jeweled parasol made of pearls and jewels. They're all very wealthy. And they bring it, and when they get to Buddha, they take the parasol and they put it in front of him as an offering. You know, because Indian sun, you know, like an umbrella for the sun. And they put it in a big stack of these jeweled parasols and pearls and things, very fancy ones. So then Buddha, and then they sit down and they're ready to, they're going to ask some questions, they want some teaching. They made a gift ring, they circumambulate him, and then they put him down. So then before saying anything, the Buddha, and when I translated this, I was so shocked. Because Tibetans don't really read sutras much. They study meditation manuals, you know, which draw quotes from the sutras, but they don't really read the stories of the sutras very much from the way they study Buddhism. And so I hadn't read that sutra, you know, and someone asked me to translate it. So I come, and the Buddha does a performance art, he performs a miracle, basically, where he takes all the parasols and makes one giant jeweled parasol covering the whole assembly of people, like a geodesic dome, huge thing, like this. And I couldn't figure out what it was, and then I realized it was the Rose Planetarium. It was like a planetarium because they look, it's described. You see, as soon as these precious parasols had been laid down, suddenly by the miraculous power of the Lord Buddha, they were transformed into a single precious canopy so great that it formed a covering for this entire billion world galaxy. Not just the planet, but like billions of worlds, you know, like the cosmos or the whole thing, all the stars and everything. He said, the surface of the entire billion-world galaxy was reflected in the interior of the great precious canopy, where the total content of the galaxy could be seen. Limitless mansions of suns, moons, and stellar bodies, the realms of the gods, dragons, goblins, fairies, etc., etc., as well as the realms of the four great kings of the directions, all the mountain ranges, all the great oceans, rivers, bays, torrents, streams, brooks, and springs. Finally, all the villages, cities, suburbs, capitals, provinces, and wildernesses. All this could be clearly seen by everyone. And the voices of all the Buddhas of the ten directions, that is, Buddhas in other worlds and so on, could be heard proclaiming their teachings of the Dharma in all the worlds, the sounds reverberating in the space beneath the great precious canopy. So in other words, he creates like a close encounter of the third kind, much more than just some people coming from one world. One little kind of weird Casper the Ghost, you know, is coming in big metal machine. Although it was a great vision when it was hanging over. Remember when that they came over? It's like Times Square hanging upside down with the force of anti-gravity. Spielberg did a good job with that one. But still, that's just one machine, and the guy inside is like the Casper the Ghost. So the little guy comes out, you know, like it doesn't even look as strong as E.T. And this is like, they see many worlds in there, and they see millions of people in this great planetarium show that he does for them. They see the interconnection of the whole universe, multiverse, they see right away. He should makes that vision. So then the leader of the young yuppies, whose name is Ratnakara, which means jewel mine, he really likes that. So he recites some verses of praise that are really very beautiful in Sanskrit. Pure are your eyes, broad and beautiful, like the petals of a blue lotus. Pure is your thought, having discovered the supreme transcendence of all trances, you know, meditative states. Immeasurable is the ocean of your virtues, the accumulation of your good deeds. You affirm the path of peace. O great ascetic, obeisance to you. And they go on with, you know, about Lord, leader, bull of men. We behold the revelation of your miracle. The superb and radiant fields of the Sugatas. That's one of the names of Buddha. It means Sukhamgata, one who realized bliss, that means. They used to translate it as welfarer. Ridiculous translation. You know, Sugata means a blissful one. And your extensive spiritual teachings that lead to immortality make themselves heard throughout the whole reach of space. Dharma King, you rule with the Dharma, your supreme Dharma King. Anyway, they give a big praise, and then they give the essence of the teaching actually here. All these things arise dependently from causes, yet they are neither existent nor non-existent. Therein is neither ego nor experiencer nor doer, yet no action, good or evil, loses its effects. Such is your teaching. That's a very deep teaching right away they give. This is just a verse of praise at the beginning. And they go on, and I like the last verse particularly. And they say, they talk more about how his amazing abilities and what a Buddha is. And then the last one they said, you associate with living beings by frequenting their migrations. That means where they transmigrate, where they live and die and live and die and live and die. They're all immigrants. All beings are immigrants. You know, and you migrate, the easiest way to migrate without having to deal with Homeland Security is to die and take rebirth in another country. That's the fast way. Then you automatically have birth certificates, you know, although some Donald Trump won't believe that if you're Obama. But the migrant, we're all immigrants, you know. We come from other worlds, we come from other lives, from other countries, other nations, other genders, other animal forms even, not always human, according to Buddhism. So one of the words for a living being in Buddhism is migrant, a goer, literally, someone who's always going somewhere. So he says, you associate with living beings by frequenting their migrations, yet your mind is liberated from all migrations. Just as the lotus born of mud is not tainted thereby, so the lotus of the Buddha preserves the realization of emptiness. You nullify all signs in all things everywhere. You are not subject to any wish for anything at all. The miraculous power of the Buddhas is inconceivable. I bow to you who stand nowhere like infinite space. See, that he's referring to the reality body of Buddha, what they call the reality body, where an enlightened being feels their body is all reality. So they're not in any particular place. They're unlocated anywhere because they are everywhere, you know, type of thing. Okay? That's a good way of praying. I mean, praise is really good, the guy does. So then he says, well, Buddha, after the praises, he then says, then the young Lichavi Ratnakara, that's the people of Vaishali, they're called Lichavis, having celebrated the Buddha with these verses, further addressed him. Lord Buddha, Bhagavan, you know, these 500 young Lichavis are truly on their way already to unexcelled perfect enlightenment. So they're already bodhisattvas, that is to say, they already want to evolve to become Buddhas. They already know that teacher, they're already beginning, they're practitioners, in other words, he said. And they have asked, however, what is the bodhisattva's perfection of the Buddha field or the Buddha land? So they say they themselves are going to be Buddhas. But what they don't understand is how do you transform the universe into a Buddha land? You see, there's a, furthermore, not only is a Buddha feel that they are everything, but if you become a Buddha, because you feel connected to every being, like a mother to her only child, every single being, you naturally want to create an environment for all the beings within your ken that is the ideal environment for them to learn in. It's like if you're a teacher, you know, you don't want to just talk to them. You want to have a video, you want to have a film, you want everything to teach them, hopefully, you know, if possible. You know what I mean? Even the environment, the classroom should be teaching. That would be the ideal form of teaching. It's like 4D theater. Have you ever been to a 4D movie? I never have, but someone told me about it. You know what 4D is? You never see 4D? There's a big 4D theater in Bangkok. You've been there? You went to the one in Bangkok? So my friend went there too. 4D means that that you sit in a chair and you have 3D glasses, right? So things seem to come out from the screen. But also, if you're in a field of flowers, a smell radiates from the seat in front of you. And if there was one scene in a movie that my friend saw where somebody was saved from starving on another planet in some sci-fi movie and they vomited, and then it sprayed up. Not, it wasn't vomit, it was just water. But, and then your seat moves around, you know, and the seat goes like that. So that's 4D. So in other words, the movie is all surround, you know, like surround sound and then physical phenomena are part of the movie. I never went there. It's in that big mall in Bangkok,
it's
right?
It's big in Thailand now.
In Thailand? Oh, it's a big thing in Thailand? You Thai people are so clever, really. Okay, anyway, that's 4D theater. So a Buddha land means that even the world teaches you of a Buddha. You know, like in the Sukhavati, there are some sutras that describe in great detail sort of celestial, heavenly Buddha lands, like where Amitabha lives, where Amitabha lives. It's called Sukhavati, the blissful land. And everything is made of jewel plasma, and you don't have it, there's no sexual differentiation. And you feel you have both male and everybody's transgender. They're all androgynous. They have male and female. So they're in blissful union with themselves all the time, all the people. They're living in a lotus. And they don't need to go and have a date on Saturday night and chase somebody around. And they don't have ordinary food. It's just the air gives them energy, you know, and therefore no excretion and so on. I know one Zen master, a Japanese, who was teased Gary Snyder once in a lecture, and he said, "You Americans, you wouldn't like the Pure Land." He said, "I can just see the great poet here." He knew who Gary Snyder was. "I can see the great poet here writing a poem saying, 'We don't want to go to that Pure Land because they don't have no restaurants and no toilets.'" He was a Zen master from Japan, but he had a great sense of humor. Anyway, so it's a completely a different kind of world like that. And the Buddha's always there and always teaching. And then a duck goes by made of jewel plasma. And instead of going quack, the duck goes, "Noble truth of suffering, noble truth of cause of suffering, noble truth of nirvana, noble truth of eightfold path." So everything is, the leaves, you know, the jewel trees tinkle like that, and then the teachings of shunyata, emptiness and compassion, come out of the trees, you know, like you hear the teaching, everything teaches, it's like that. So they're saying, they're asking Buddha, they say, "Well, we're trying to become Buddhas ourselves, you know, we're going to be Buddhas, and not just our hats, we're going to be Buddhas. We're on the path of unexcelled perfect enlightenment, but we can't just figure out how you change the whole world. How do you do that?" And that's a question. So it's a very different, unusual question to ask. So now Buddha goes into a long story. He says, "Noble son." So he says, good young man, your question to the Tathagata, oh gosh, what a typo. Tathagata about the purification and perfection of the Buddha land or Buddha field is indeed good. Therefore, young man, listen well and remember, I will explain to you the purification or the perfection of the Buddha field or the Buddha land of the Bodhisattvas. "Very good, Lord Bhagavan," replied Ratnakara and the 500 young Lichavis, and they set themselves to listen. And he said, "Noble sons, a Buddha field of Bodhisattvas is a field of living beings. Why so? A bodhisattva embraces a Buddha land to the same extent that he causes the development of living beings. That is to say, what the world, what the universe really is an intersubjective mind field of beings, which doesn't just mean only human beings. It means subhuman animal beings. It means gods. That it is, you know, at the intersection of our minds is the world we perceive. And so that's why language is so important in Buddhism, because language is the collective sort of neurons, you know, of the mass of living beings, and we have a mass mind through language, right? Not just since Facebook, you know. We always did, you know. Once you have a language, you have millions of people thinking the same things, you know. Facebook just sort of electronically interconnects it, which is very interesting as far as this Buddha land goes, actually, but that's another topic. So he embraces it to the same extent that living beings become disciplined and evolve. He embraces the Buddha field or Buddha land to the same extent that, though nowadays I would say, actually nowadays I call it a Buddhaverse, like a universe, but a Buddhaverse, not a universe turning around the one, the me, you know, but a Buddhaverse, a reality that turns around enlightened beings. That's what I say. I don't say Buddha land or Buddha field. I say Buddhaverse. So I would edit this and make it my modern terms anyway. So he embraces a Buddha field to the same extent that through entrance into a Buddha field, living beings are introduced to the Buddha gnosis or the Buddha intuition, the Buddha wisdom. He embraces the Buddha field to the same extent that through entrance into that Buddha field, living beings increase their holy spiritual faculties, you know, which are faith, kindness, wisdom, generosity, detachment, etc. Those are called the spiritual faculties. Why so? Noble child, I should have translated. A Buddha field of bodhisattvas springs from the aims of living beings. For example, Ratnakara, should one wish to build in empty space, one might go ahead, in spite of the fact that it is not possible to build or to adorn anything in empty space. In just the same way, should a bodhisattva who knows full well that all things are like empty space, wish to build a Buddha field in order to develop living beings, he might go ahead, in spite of the fact that it is not possible to build or to adorn a Buddha field in empty space. That's a very cryptic one. And there are different versions in Chinese and Tibetan translated differently. But what that means is that you can't think of creating the Buddhaverse as like some sort of concrete thing, like you make a building, you know, with wood and plaster and so on. You make it in the minds of beings through culture, through teaching, through science, and through art, you know. Yes, Ratnakara. So then he goes on. Bodhisattva's Buddha field is a field of positive thought. When he attains enlightenment, living beings free of hypocrisy and deceit will be born in his Buddha field. Noble son, a Bodhisattva's Buddhaverse is a field of high resolve. That means the resolution to save other beings from suffering. And he goes on, with every conceivable virtue, a Bodhisattva's Buddhaverse is the magnificence of the conception of the spirit of enlightenment. In other words, they believe that someone who has the ideal of the Bodhisattva is a magnificent thing to have. That the ordinary human being is beaten down by society to have a very lowly expectation. Well, maximum will become a millionaire, or I guess a billionaire nowadays, and then I die and I don't have anything, right? And you know, nobody can really do much. If you become president, you just get a headache and your hair turns white, you know, and nobody knows why Hillary is so determined, you know, instead of relaxing. But she wants to do it and she's going to do a good job. So, point is, you know, we have low expectations. Nobody thinks I could become a Buddha. Like when you even hold your baby, you know, and you think, oh, I hope you're a movie star. I hope you can be president. I hope you can be like a concert violinist. I hope you can, you know, that's all. What is all of that? Olympic athlete, oh, I want you to win the decathlon. What a strenuous, horrible thing to have to go out and train all the time. In other words, we just don't expect much out of life. And it doesn't bother us that we don't, of course, modern people, because we're materialists at some level, even we have a theory about something, and we think that we're only here this life, and we just hope to get through to death, and then we won't exist, so no more problem. You know, we're a little bit like, we have this kind of false casualness, because we're not afraid of going forward with our mind or soul without gaining control of our mind and soul. So we know where we're going to go, how we're going to go. Like we wouldn't fly to go to Brooklyn without knowing the path and having a map of the subway and the address and the whole thing. We wouldn't even go. So imagine you leave your body and go and find a new one with no map and no control, no driver, no ticket. That's why people who really feel the presence of them, their continuum of life after life, take it really seriously. It's not like the materialists wrongly think that people who think they're going to have a future life are like wishful thinking. You know, like Carl Sagan. Oh yeah, like if I was a simple-minded, I would think, oh yeah, next life I'll have tenure at Cornell again, and then I'll make another cosmos. Right, so I'm going to make it this life because I'm not silly and I'm ready to not exist, and I'm brave enough to not exist. He wrongly thinks, but that's totally wrong. Not existing is the easy way out. There's no pain. It's like sleeping forever. Everybody wants to fall asleep after 12 hours of being awake, and sometimes only after 3 or 4. I want a nap. So what's the big? I'm not scared not to exist. We are delighted not to be conscious and not exist every night and just go unconscious. We're delighted. That's the easy way out. You know, like Hamlet said, right? To die, to sleep, perhaps to dream. Oh, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, when we have shoveled off this mortal coil, what dreams may come must give us pause. That's the future life right there. What are you going to dream? If it's your unconscious making you just dream any old thing, then you're going to be worried about it. It's unconscious, has all kinds of things in it. Okay, anyway. So anyway, Buddha goes on a long talk about it's a field of generosity. When a Buddha, the Buddha verse of a Buddha, there's nobody who's even stingy the slightest. Everyone wants to give everything to everybody else. It's like the land is generous, you know, that you can like, eat the land, you know. It's so delicious, you know, type of idea. So anyway, he finally ends by saying the perfection or purity of the Buddhaverse reflects the purity of living beings. The purity of the living beings reflects the purity of his intuitive wisdom. The purity of his intuitive wisdom reflects the purity of his teaching. The purity of his teaching reflects the purity of his transcendental practice. And the purity of his transcendental practice reflects the purity of his own mind. So Buddha has a perfectly pure, perfect mind, so the world is perfect. So then Shariputra, who is the head monk, you know, of the Hinayana, you know, dualistic Buddhism, he thinks to himself, actually, he doesn't really think much. He's an arhat, you know. He doesn't bother to think much. He meditated so much, he doesn't really think. But Buddha plants the thought in his mind. The Buddha's kind of wicked that way. He kind of psychically, through telepathy, he makes him think that. But so he thinks something logical. He thinks, wait a minute. If Shakyamuni Buddha is a Buddha, he was a bodhisattva for thousands and millions of lifetimes. If his mind was pure, then this world here, then India, 2500 BCE, should be pure. But it's horrible, it's full of crap. It's all kind of suffering here, it's not pure. What's the matter with Shakyamuni Buddha? He must have been one lousy bodhisattva with no perfect mind. He thinks that. So of course Buddha reads his mind. He's very mean to Shariputra. He says, therefore, magically influenced by the Buddha, the venerable Shariputra had this thought. If the Buddha verse is pure only to the extent that the mind of the bodhisattva is pure, then when Shakyamuni Buddha was engaged in the career of the bodhisattva, his mind must have been impure. Otherwise, how could this Buddha verse here be so impure? And then the Buddha, knowing telepathically the thought of the venerable Shariputra, said to him, what do you think, Shariputra? Is it because the sun and moon are impure that those blind from birth do not see them? No, Lord, no, poor Shariputra, he's very patient, but he knows what's coming. He's going to get criticized. No, Lord, it is not so. The fault lies with those blind from birth, not with the sun and moon. So the Buddha said, in the same way, Shariputra, the fact that some beings do not behold the splendid display of the virtues of the Buddha field of the Tathagata, you know, the realized, you know, transcendent Buddha, is due to their own ignorance. It is not the fault of the Tathagata. Shariputra, the Buddha field of the Tathagata is perfect. It's pure, but you do not see it. Then Brahma Shikin chimes in. That's the creator. But, you know, Buddhists don't, he says he's not a creator, that people wrongly think that. He says, I don't take responsibility for evil. I'm very powerful, but I didn't create the world. I'm just the first person here. There's a sutra. We read that sutra together, right? Didn't we? We read that, where Kivada goes and asks the creator, how did you create the world? What was there before you created it? Where does it end, all your creation, you know? And he couldn't answer, and then he said, I didn't create it, so I don't know. Go ask Buddha, he said. And get Buddha to tell people, in another version, that I didn't create their suffering, because I don't like them being angry with me. He said, but he's a very big, powerful God, but he's not a creator. Anyway, he's there, so he's the most powerful person there other than Buddha. So he scolds Shariputra too. He says, in the same way, Shariputra, the fact that some beings, no, the Brahma Shikin said to Shariputra, Reverend Shariputra, do not say that the Buddha verse of the Tathagata is impure. Reverend Shariputra, the Buddha verse of the Tathagata is perfectly pure. I see the splendid expanse of the Buddha field of the Lord Shakyamuni as equal to the splendor of, for example, the abodes of the highest deities. His own abode, that means. But Shariputra holds his ground with this God, and he says, as for me, O Brahma, I see this great earth with its highs and lows, its thorns, its precipices, its peaks, and its abysses, as if it were entirely filled with crap. And the Brahma says to him, the fact that you see such a Buddha verse as this, as if it were to be impure, so impure, Reverend Shariputra, is a sure sign that there are highs and lows in your mind, and that your positive thought in regard to the Buddha wisdom is not pure either. Reverend Shariputra, those whose minds are impartial toward all living beings, and whose positive thoughts toward the Buddha intuitive wisdom are pure, see this Buddha field as perfectly pure. So this is the Mahayana, you see. So at that point, thereupon the Lord Bhagavan Buddha touched the what is that? This scan. Touch the ground, of this billion world galactic universe. with his big toe. So somehow he went like that with his foot. Must have been barefoot. And he puts his toe on the ground like that, Buddha does. He has a very big, big toe. He has all big feet, Buddha. One of the signs of a Buddha. And suddenly it was transformed into a huge mass of precious jewels, a magnificent array of many hundreds of thousands of clusters of precious gems, until it resembled the universe of the Tathagata Ratnavyuha, called Ananta Guna Ratnavyuha. You know, that's a jewel universe. But that jewel means not little hard diamonds and rubies and things, but everything is plasma, like jewel, like ruby plasma, diamond plasma, you know, sapphire plasma, you know. So soft and warm and stuff, not like a cold, hard, sharp jewel, but still just precious like that. And everyone in the entire assembly was filled with wonder, each perceiving himself or herself seated on a throne of jewel lotuses. So now this, we must meditate on this now, okay? Everyone should meditate for a couple minutes now. And I want you to meditate on this vision that the Buddha created temporarily in the mind of everyone. Okay? And what is this vision? Usually, we think of, we live in a very imperfect world. And we're always worried, am I in the best chair? Am I in the best city? Am I in the best house? Do I have the best clothes? You know, because it's all filled with, you know, negative things. And we want something a little positive. So we're always maneuvering around like that. And then as far as spiritual development goes, we think, well, Buddha lived thousands of years ago. I didn't get to meet Buddha. So I may have a nice teacher, but it's not like Buddha. So I can't expect that I'm going to really gain enlightenment. And but best I can do is try not to cause harm and, you know, be good, behave and whatever, try to and learn something. But, you know, so we generally have a sense of ourselves as very imperfect and the world as very imperfect. And even if we are faithful Buddhists, like the people in this assembly, in this text, who are there with the actual Buddha in the old days, and they've seen Buddha, how extraordinary he is, and so they have great faith in that Buddha, and they've learned a lot from him, but we're not like that. So imagine suddenly you had the experience that you were in the perfect place for yourself to do just what you need to evolve into a higher being with the maximum optimal efficiency. In other words, everything that has happened to you in your life has been the perfect thing for you to learn from. And you to develop, you know, and to then have a better next life, to understand something, to improve your understanding, to improve your insight, to improve your self-control, to improve your inner, harmony and balance. That you, the circumstances are, that doesn't mean you've taken advantage of them, but it's like, you know, we go to school and we say, well, okay, I learned something in that course, but the teacher wasn't very good and the books weren't that great. And I was so busy and I didn't study that hard. So, you know, I didn't take advantage of the opportunity. But imagine you had a sudden vision that everything that has happened to you and everything now that is happening to you is the best of all possible things that could happen to you for your particular capacity, for your special, that there is all good and all kind and all intelligent awareness enfolding you and your circumstances. And so that if you just look for it, if you more expect it, if you look deeper into your surrounding, into what happens to you, you can learn from everything just what you need to know. So they put this in this text in the context of having a vision of everything having maximum value. In a way, their own body is jewel plasma. They sit in a jewel lotus. The whole world is made of jewel plasma. They're like in a celestial, heavenly space suddenly, you know. Because the Buddha's power of shaping the space to be the best possible space, you know, what Voltaire in the West cynically called best of all possible worlds for you specifically. Meditate, how You know, try to imagine that yourself, and imagine then how you would react to things that happened to you. You know, usually we're like, oh, I wish that had never happened. Oh, no, I don't want. We run away from the other thing. We, you know, and that doesn't mean we might not choose this or that option. And yet, we, instead of having a kind of default expectation of like Murphy's Law, you know, whatever can go wrong will go wrong, we realize even what goes wrong, if we take it as an opportunity, it can be the best thing that ever happened to us. How would you face a day thinking, I must take advantage, in an evolutionary sense, positive sense, of every single thing that happens to me and that I do in this day, with no limit to how much progress and how much improvement and how much joy I can find and how much joy I can share with others. There's no limit. How would I face that day? So imagine we are a Lichavi from the city of Vaishali. And we're sitting in a giant assembly with all kinds of creatures. A vast host, like one of those congresses in Star Wars, where people are sitting at all different levels and all around all different kind of weird creatures. And suddenly the world seems perfectly adapted to my needs, my real needs, you know, what really benefits me, some new insight, some new level of inner well-being, some new level of sense of appropriateness of my surrounding, of my family, my friends, my even my enemies. They're all helping me without they're not necessarily realizing it. The sky is helping me, the television, even some of the idiots running for office are helping me by showing me how not to behave. And you remember I said, why was Buddha, when we were even reading the individual vehicle Buddhist texts from Pali, translated from Pali, that the reason people love Buddha in the world is that the Buddha discovered that the default reality is fine, it's nirvana. The real reality is nirvana. The reality of suffering is less real. It's not completely non-existent, but it's less real. And the more real will inevitably overwhelm the less real. And the Buddha's compassion is manifested as an energy, a world-transforming energy that surrounds all the beings in the Buddha's field of awareness. And that's what this vision at the beginning of Mahayana Sutra tells us. And if you meditate on it. You're in the perfect place for what you need to know and experience. And your companions are the perfect companions to help you do that. And the higher intelligence of the Buddha mind is all around. And you just have to look for it, and you can see it in everything if you look more closely. So that's the first chapter. Okay, ding.
Nityananda. So Shariputra loves it. He says, oh, he says to Shariputra, the Buddha, he says, do you see the splendor of the virtues of the Buddha field? And Shariputra says, yes, I do. Here before me is a display of splendor such as I never before heard of or beheld. And Buddha said, Shariputra, this Buddha field is always thus pure, but the Tathagata makes it appear to be spoiled by many faults in order to bring about the maturity of inferior living beings. And so if this extraordinary like kaleidoscope that shows itself, the world shows itself to beings in just what they need to learn, so different beings see it in different ways. And he gives an example of that. And though everyone has this amazing experience of suddenly feeling they're in the, just the right place for themselves. And then the Buddha picked up his foot, you know, and then it just looks, it reverts back to being like it had been before, you know. And so, and thereupon 32,000 living beings purified their immaculate, undistorted Dharma eye. That means more realistic vision in regard to all things. The 8,000 mendicant bhikshus were liberated from their mental defilements, attaining the state of non-grasping. And they're already arhat, so for them non-grasping means not being attached to nirvana. And the 84,000 living beings who were devoted to the grandeur of the Buddha field, having understood that all things are by nature but magical creations, all conceived in their own minds the spirit of unexcelled, totally perfect enlightenment. So, in other words, this is what the Mahayana, now this is the, so this is the bigger revelation of the Mahayana. Buddha never left. Shakyamuni Buddha didn't leave. We don't have to feel that we are lost in a dark history later, far later than Shakyamuni Buddha. And we, you know, we could have had a chance to be enlightened if we'd only lived when Shakyamuni Buddha lived. That's the way people tend to feel in the Buddhist world. Oh, I miss Shakyamuni. I hope I'm here for the next Buddha when Maitreya comes. I hope I can be here at that time. You sort of have a very lowly expectation. That's a big theme in the sutra. So the revelation of it is that this is we're in Shakyamuni's world. His mind is completely wrapped around it and every being in it. And it's the best of all possible worlds for us to learn from. Even when terrible things happen, it's the best of all. It's the best thing that could possibly happen. It's a shocking vision. You see why he held it back. Because some nasty king or some terrible dictator could have used it as an excuse if they didn't have some level of understanding of the transcendent nature of the voidness, of emptiness, to say, well, if it's best of all worlds, then I'm just going to kill everybody and then that'll be fine. You know? And he didn't want that misunderstanding. Because that would be the worst of all things that person could do. They'll be in hell as many lives as they take. They'll lose their life in horrible ways that many times. So, okay, so Shakyamuni Buddha is right there. And this is a Buddha land. And actually, there's even an argument later on in one of the chapters, which I will read in another class. There's an argument that, you know, at one point, the Buddha, at one point in the conversation, it's getting toward noon. And Shariputra is worrying, what about lunch? I won't get any lunch, and then I won't be able to eat till tomorrow morning because I can only eat before noon. He's a bhikshu, right? It's a monk, a mendicant. So, and there's a lot of elder monks here. You know, there's thousands of people in the house, in Vimalakirti's audience. And what's going to happen to them? They're going to be really, they might get sick, they're going to be very hungry. And so Vimalakirti says, Shariputra, did you come here to listen to the Dharma? Or did you come here for lunch? And then Shariputra, oh, I came for the Dharma, he says, but it's just that I'm worried about all the other old folks here that they're going to be too hungry if they don't get food before noon. And then Vimalakirti gives Shariputra a big scold about it. But then he sends out for lunch. So Vimalakirti creates a magical bodhisattva gopher who's a golden bodhisattva. He creates like a second person, just like that, by magic. And he says, you go to the universe of the Buddha Sugandhakuta, which means a mountain of good of perfume, of excellent perfume.
And with that universe is called Sarvaganda Suganda, perfumed by all perfect, you know, excellent perfumes. And you ask that Buddha in that universe for a little bit of rice from his bowl, leftover from his bowl. Just a small bit and bring it back, a few grains. And that universe, by the way, is in the northern, some, I forget which direction, eastern direction, beyond as many other universes as there are grains of sand in 62 Ganges riverbeds. And that Bodhisattva goes in speed of thought to that place. He's a very quick gopher. And he gets this, and he asks for this rice, and he and the Buddha gives it. Oh, Vimalakirti, okay, yeah, he can get some, right? Give some rice. And then he's going to go back and take this back. And then there are bodhisattvas in that universe, incense universe, and their bodies are made of incense. The trees, the land, it's all perfume, the whole thing. And that Buddha doesn't talk. He just radiates a perfume. And when they smell that, they go into samadhi. And they get deep insights and all this. And therefore, it's very easy for them to evolve and become highly enlightened. And therefore, they're quite bored. And so they say, oh, they say to their Buddha, Buddha, what kind of person must that Vimalakirti be coming from Shakyamuni Buddha's world and coming here for a leftover from your dish for lunch for people there? That's amazing. Can we go with him, back with him and see who had meet Vimalakirti and see what that world is like? We just like a little excursion. And he says, yeah, you can go. Okay, fine. You guys have transportation powers. You know, you are like the transporter room, you know, you have your own transporter. You can go. But one thing, you have to change your body when you get there. If those human beings in Shakyamuni's universe take one sniff of your smell, they're going to go completely crazy. They're going to get totally stoned. They never smelled such a delicious smell. They'll just go nuts. He said, so you have to change your body, make it more coarse, you know, more ordinary body. Oh yeah, we can do that, no problem. We'll change our mind. So then they all go shooting, thousands of them, they go with the gopher bodhisattva. And then when they get to this planet, they're like, ooh, like P.U., like, oh, wow, what's wrong with this Buddha? Where's his incense trees, you know, where's his infrastructure? It's a crappy infrastructure here, what's going on? And they really freaked out. And so they talk to Vimalakirti. Vimalakirti first, he feeds everybody with these few grains of rice. And everybody feeds like an infinite bowl, you know, thousands of people. And then each person who takes a bite, they start smelling like that. And then the monks are very freaked out because they're not allowed to wear perfume or deodorant or anything. Monks can't do that. It's against the rule. I know they're smelling. How can we get rid of this smell? This is terrible. And then Timothy says, you can't. The only way you can get rid of that smell is you have to attain the next level of insight. And then it'll go away. There's no way you can wash it off. There's no way. You're going to have to attain the next level of deep, deep understanding of selflessness, which they already understand some level, but they have the deeper level of selflessness at the instinctual level, and then it'll stop smelling. So that he does. But then the bodhisattvas have a conversation with him, the ones from incense world. And they say, like, what's the matter with what does this Buddha do? What does he teach here? And Vimalakirti says, oh, he talks about, oh, that's hell over there. That's the preta world. That's the animal world. Oh, that's the suffering. And they go on, and they never heard such things, these bodhisattvas. And then he says, how do they teach in your world? And he says, oh, we just take a sniff, and we go in samadhi, and we realize everything. And so Vimalakirti says, yeah, actually, your Buddhaverse is less good than Shakyamuni's Buddhaverse. Because you don't have some things on your universe. And what is it you don't have? You don't have suffering. You don't have suffering being. Therefore, all you can do is cultivate your meditative power and your wisdom. You can't cultivate your compassion. How can you develop compassion for others? Which is where you have to expand your identification with them. Unless you're in some area near, you couldn't be in hell, then you're so much in your own pain you can't help. But you have to be in just a middle place where you're not that suffering and they're not that suffering, but they are suffering quite a lot, and you therefore can begin to develop the expansion of your empathy and your identification, your compassion. You guys would be up there sniffing for a billion aeons of you, big bang, big crunches, big bang, big crunches. You'll be there for billions of those before you can get as much compassion as you can get in a few lifetimes in Shakyamuni Buddha's Buddhaverse. So he makes that argument, you know, best of all possible worlds, and because it's not that great. So there's some challenge in it. We have to, challenge of suffering, we have to overcome. So we can learn more deep, more quickly, because to become a Buddha, it's not just your wisdom, it's your compassion you have to develop. Wisdom is the mind, but the body is developed by compassion. And the body has to expand to embrace all life. That's a huge physical expansion, and only compassion is the cause of that expansion. You follow me? Dealing with the relative world. That's the only way to do it. So they make that argument. I mean, you know, you could be skeptical. I remember once, in 1971, I was in India. I hadn't translated this book yet, but I knew about Mauna Kea and all that, and the Bangladesh war was going on in Bangladesh. I was in Himalayas. And I was very aware of it, and it was in the press, and it was really so atrocious what was going on. And I had this dream that my old Mongolian teacher was sitting in the garden of this villa I lived in the high mountains, really beautiful place, in Almora, in India. And he wasn't talking, he was just sitting there looking kind of serious. And I was protesting, and I was scolding him. And I was saying, where's that Nirmana Kaya of the Buddha? You know, Buddha is supposed to be Dharmakaya everywhere and can manifest whatever people need. Where is he? How can this be going on? All these infants, they were bayoneting babies. I mean, it was just horrendous what was going on in Bangladesh, you know. Remember the famous concert, you know, George Harris, and whatever it was. Terrible thing. And I was not shouting, but I was scolding my teacher. And I was saying, where is that Dharmakaya? There must be no such thing. How can it be? And he didn't say anything. But then, as I was more and more ranting at him, he got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, and pretty soon I was like a little flea at his knee. You know, on somewhere deep, his knee was like a mountain. And this was in a place where you could see 26,000 foot mountain, snow peak mountains in North India, in the Himalaya. And he blotted them all out. It was bigger than all the mountains. And then I woke up. I was still frustrated. But it sort of was the lesson, you know. The strange things that happen in the world. How the reality works. You know? I don't know. So that's the central message of the Vimalakirti. And the Vimalakirti says other maybe amazing, preposterous things about emptiness and so on. Next time we will look at the section on, they have this concept, in those days I translated skill and liberative technique. Now I would just skill and liberative art I would translate. I'm going to retranslate this actually. I'm going to edit it. The publisher wants me to edit it, but I haven't gotten around to it. And then, Vimalakirti is sick. And then Buddha keeps asking everybody to go talk to Vimalakirti and console him because he's sick. That's the action of the sutra. And nobody wants to go. Shariputra, he says, Shariputra, go ask Vimalakirti how he's feeling and give him our good wishes and ask if you can be of any help and hope he feels better soon. You know, it's like it's a thing in the Buddhist community to go and, you know, take some chicken soup type of thing to the sick person. It's like a thing, you know. And he says, oh, I don't really feel like it today, Buddha. I'm sorry, I really, really don't want to go. Shariputra says. And Buddha says, well, why not? But he's a nice layman. He's one of the members of our Buddhist community. Why don't you want to go? And he says, well, last time I saw him, I was meditating, he said. And I was under the foot of a tree and I was meditating. And Shariputra was a famous meditator. And he would meditate so deeply he wouldn't know what was going on around him. And so, and then Vimalakirti came there, he says, and he interrupted my meditation, and he said, Shariputra, this is not the way to meditate. He said, you should only meditate in such a way that neither body nor mind appear to be existing anywhere in the world. And Shariputra was actually had withdrawn into his mind, but he knew he was sitting under a tree and he was like isolating himself from everything. So Vimalakirti was saying, you have to get rid of your body and mind. They shouldn't be anywhere in the world. That's how you meditate. In other words, you leave the inside and the outside. You don't even perceive yourself. And he gets a long spiel like that, how Shariputra was doing a dualistic meditation. And then he said, and then he gave such a brilliant speech, and I temporarily understood what he meant. And my meditation sort of expanded into encompassing everything instead of isolating from everything, he said. But then I couldn't think of anything to say, and it was kind of like a rough ride, you know, to have all my views criticized. So I just don't feel like it today. And then everybody has a story like that. That, you know, Vimalakirti came and this happened, that happened. But then when Manjushri, who's the Bodhisattva of wisdom, the most intelligent, the wisest, he's a Buddha actually, who pretends to be a Bodhisattva, and himself. And he says, I'll go and talk to him. Well, I can't resist him. He's like the most eloquent person, most critical person. But I'll go and have a chat, no problem. I'll go. And the minute he says that, they all say, oh, we'd like to go and hear what you have to say. So they all do want to go and hear him. They just don't want to be the brunt of his critical insight themselves, you know. But they were happy to see Manjushri be there, you know, hide behind Manjushri. So then they all run off to see Vimalakirti. There's some great stories. But this is, again, now there's another Mahayana thing. One of them, now the famous thing in the Buddhist world was where he criticized those monks. And that would be like in the Christian world, if the, you know, some layman who lived in Jerusalem would criticize St. Peter, St. Paul, St. Thomas, all of them, and they say they were just didn't understand Jesus at all, you know, and give them a big scold, but a critical teaching, you know. Not just a scold, but a critical teaching. So people were so in Buddhist societies where they respect the mendicants so much. To see the mendicants be criticized by a layman was very exciting, especially Chinese people love that, Japanese people, Korean people. And Indian people originally, I'm sure, did. Tibetans were not so into it because they're all a bunch of monks, you know. But they weren't so excited about it. But some of the people he criticized were not necessarily monks. One of them was a householder named Jagatimdara. And Jagatimdara tells the story that he was meditating one day. He was a layman, but he was a meditator. And the devil came there, Mara. But the devil impersonated the god Indra, the Zeus sort of figure in the Indian imaginary. And then he said, oh, Jagatimdara, I have like 200 girls here, beautiful maidens who can wait on you. I want to give them to you, he said. And I don't know, lots of them. Yeah. And then I thought it was the god Indra, you know, so I was thinking what to do. I didn't really want them, but you know, you can't say no to the god Indra, I was thinking. And suddenly Vimalakirti showed up. And he said, Jagatimdara, don't believe that person. That's not Indra. That's the devil, Mara. And he wants to corrupt you with all these females, you know, like get you like off your meditation. So don't listen to that. But you know what, Mara? I'll take the girls if you want to give them away. So then he takes all the girls. And then he gives them a teaching and he says, there's something called the delight of the Dharma, the delight of reality, which is much better than the delight of passion. And they really like it. And they're intelligent, you know, they're goddesses, actually, because the devil lives in a certain heaven in India. He's not like down in the underworld, some kind of weird, scaly thing. He lives up in a heaven, sort of more like a pimp than like a horrible character. And he seduces people, you know. And so he teaches these girls. And then Mara wants to run away, but he has a magic power and Mara can't move. Mara has to listen too, and he's just sitting there like gritting his teeth. He's very angry at the devil. So he teaches them, and they get it, that the reality itself is a deeper kind of bliss than passion can give, you know, which involves an object and it's impermanent. Whereas reality, the more you're open to reality, you realize the natural bliss in your own cells of your body, and you don't have to go off and huff and puff and whatever. And they like it. Called Dharmarati. So then at some point, they get it, kind of. And then Mara, finally, he protests and he interrupts after the girls have understood. And then Mara says, okay, I understand you, Vimalakirti, are a Bodhisattva. And Bodhisattvas give whatever people ask of them. So I want my girls back. So Bhima says, okay, yeah, you can have them back. And then they say, oh no, we don't want to go back with him. And back in his, like, you know, cat house heaven, we don't want to go back there. And he said, listen, ladies, I'll teach you one more teaching before I give you back. And that's called the teaching of the inexhaustible lamp. And that means there's a lamp that no matter how many other lamps it lights, it never stops burning. So now that you understand the delight of the Dharma, of reality, you know, of the truth, you know, reality, you can teach all the other goddesses in Mara's heaven about it, and then they won't want to go and seduce people for him. But he doesn't quite spell out his motive, but he does that. And then Mara says, oh, drat, you know, and then he, come on, girls, and he goes back to his place, and Mimalakshita lets him go. But see, that's the difference of Mahayana. See, Buddha was under the tree, setting the example for the monks, and Mara brought his daughters to seduce Buddha, and then Buddha just saw them like, he saw their impermanence, he saw them all like old hags, he wasn't tempted, so he isolates himself from them, you see, because he's setting himself up as head monk, and he's teaching them an individual vehicle, because that's where people have to start, you see, by renouncing, right? But the Mahayana, it goes in, it actually changes the, maybe it turns the thing around and invades the devil's realm. Do you follow me? It doesn't just step away from the devil. It transforms the devil and the devil's world, you see. So it's much more aggressive, really. And it happened in India, and Buddha foresaw that. When India was ready for this bigger thing, it's like once the monks have created a space of a higher way of being, of higher understanding, higher ethics, higher mental concentration, and they're sending out a good vibe, and they've given a lot of lectures after a lot of lunches, a lot of free lunches to a lot of lay people. He very cleverly only allows those mendicants, male and female mendicants, to take one meal at a time. They have to go back and get another one the next day at another house. And then each time they get a meal, then they're willing to answer a question or give a talk or something. So he's interactive with the society, if you follow me. He's been changing the society for hundreds of years by this time. So then it's been changed enough where they can go and say, okay, well, not only are you supporting these people who are trying to live at a higher level who are monastic and feeding them and being generous and developing your generosity, but now even you people in your houses, you can start changing your consciousness. You can start living at a higher level. You can have a higher ethic in society. You follow me? So that's not a matter of failing and then wanting to be popular like the Hindus. That's a matter of being able to be more aggressive because the society has evolved. You follow me? That's how the history should be seen, as a successful change of the society. You see? Because India was progressing. It became the most advanced. The sciences of India, they're totally there. People came from China, from Indonesia, from Persia, everywhere to study in India. Jesus went to study in India, people say. It was the great, and Nalanda University was the super Oxford or Harvard or whatever you call it of those days. And not just for meditation, but medicine, architecture, painting, whatever there was, you know, fine arts, mathematics. Who discovered the decimal system? Did you know that? Those tacky Romans? You know, we hear in the West all about great Roman Empire. They make one movie after another about some crappy emperor who's running around having an orgy and vomiting and going to the vomitorium after eating three dinners. Right? They didn't even have the decimal system. So they had some slave who's going XVIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIIII people up. But they didn't even invent the decimal system. And for years, the Western people, modern people, thought the Arabs did. But the Arabs found it in India. It was invented in India by the Indians. And the word for zero is shunya. Same word as shunyata, emptiness, voidness. And they understood that zero is a place where something can take place. You follow me? So they have that intelligence. It was the highest of the ancient societies, you know, India. And anyway, so okay, any questions? You know, I'm not gonna, we're getting there now. for once, instead of talking endlessly. Come on, some question. That's the Vimalakirti.
So the Mahayana?
Yes.
Yes.
Patana, your name is Patana.
Yes.
Patana. What a great, she wrote a great movie about Buddha. Patana did. I like it, but I didn't read the whole thing. I wrote you an email. You got my email?
Yes.
I don't
Thank
have
you.
A copy. I'll
Thank
bring
you.
It next time, since
Thank
you want
you.
It.
No problem.
But I didn't read the whole thing, but it's quite
Thank
nice. It goes
you.
To Harvard. Did you go to Harvard? Oh, you just have Daphne at Harvard.
Almost, yeah.
Okay, please, what's your question?
The question about the timing. Mahayana now, is now about listen. How many years?
When you get a microphone, you hold it right up and talk to it, okay?
When the timing of the Mahayana, how many years after Buddha? I want to make sure.
When, I'm sorry, what?
The years of Mahayana, starting of the Mahayana. How many years after Buddha?
About 400, according to his prediction.
Okay.
About 400. And that's what he said. It would take 400 years, which what? If you allow 20 years for a generation, that's 20 generations to really change India in such a way that people were more had more critical and more individualistic, actually, interestingly. You know, because people, see, the great Buddha's great teaching to the Indian civilization was, I'm sorry to say, when he disobeyed his father. You know, he didn't follow, the father ordered him to be king. And even when he said, I didn't want to, he locked him up. And he was going to send the psychiatrist in there to, you know, the Brahmin priest to tell him, you got to serve, you're the king, you have to be the king. And Buddha said, no, I'm going to go attain enlightenment instead. And that was a huge shock to the closed Vedic family system world. And it meant that each individual has their own unique destiny and has their own unique ability to evolve into a higher thing. Of course they respect their parents, of course, but that doesn't mean they have to follow and do exactly what the father did, which is what the fathers tend to push their children to do that, and the mothers also in India. So he created the space for the individual, if they had a feeling they had some special something they wanted to bring out in themselves, that they didn't want to be a tailor or a shoemaker or a merchant or whatever the father was, they should have the right to do that. That's a symbol that leaving the home that Buddha did was a huge shock. If you read the biographies, you know, his wife was so upset and his father was completely upset. And then he went back and even the grandson went and became a monk. And the poor father was, but the father finally became an arhat himself and he finally got over it, but he was, you know, not happy. And the wife was not happy either at first. But eventually she became happy. She became a great mendicant herself and a great teacher, the wife.
Okay.
And actually, I think the wife, you know the story of the four sights that the Buddha saw? You know, the sick person, the old person, the dead body, and the mendicant, seeker, you know, the shramana, right? Which then he decided he was going to go and follow that path and attain enlightenment. I don't think he could live to 29, such an intelligent person, and not discover. And what I think is that his wife helped him become more realistic.
Yeah.
Once he fell in love with Yashodhara, they sneaked out together and they saw how people were living in the world slowly, you know. But the Indian patriarchal society, they didn't want to really tell the story that way because they didn't want to give the woman the credit. But I'm sure she had something to say. She was an amazing person. In the Hua Yanjing, Did you read Thomas Cleary's Flower Ornament Sutra now?
No.
I told you last week.
Okay.
The Inconceivable Liberation Sutra, the Hua Yanjing in Chinese they call it, the Buddha Avatamsaka. In that, the wife recites her vision and her samadhi and she's a Buddha actually.
Yes.
All of the people around Buddha were already Buddhas, you know, and they were doing they were creating a certain archetypal story, which was probably the most well-known story in history. Probably the Buddha life story is the most well-known life story in all of human history. I always ask Indian people, I used to when I give lectures to, you know, in India or something, I'd say, who's the most famous Indian person who from the Indian subcontinent in history? And they all say Gandhi, Nehru, and then they kind of look puzzled and then they think back and then somebody says Krishna, I say, no, Krishna was a god. And you go, they never say Buddha. But, you know, I say, no, Buddha was most famous. Everybody in China knew Buddha. That's millions and millions and billions of people. Always there were more population in India and China. Actually, India is bigger than China, even today. If you add Pakistan and Bangladesh, the stupid, you know, religious difference. But otherwise, if you add them all together, it's actually more population than China, even now. Because it's so rich, all the rivers of India, the basic resources of India, and the minerals. And it's a great story. You know? Magnificent. Lalita Vistara, the Mahayana version is called Lalita Vistara. Did you ever read that? You read Lalita Vistara?
I need to
the magnificent.
I must.
You should read that. It's a Mahayana thing. There's some English translation. You have to read that. It's so magical. Lalita Vistara. But still, the fact that Buddha was human and became enlightened, so we can become enlightened, that's very important. Another question.
Yes.
Charlie, my new friend, Charlie. Yes, from Texas. He's a Texan. He didn't bring his Texas hat.
Okay.
He left it at home.
Yeah, you mentioned earlier about the Dharma eye.
About what?
Dharma. Dharma eye. And in Diamond Sutra,
Diamond Sutra, yes.
You have the Buddha mentioned about the human eyes, the heaven eyes, the
no eye, no ear,
the
no
Dharma eyes, and the wisdom eyes, and Buddha eyes, the five eyes. Yes. You just casually mentioned that the Dharma eyes is to see the reality, right? How about the wisdom eyes?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Can you can you tell
stages.
A little bit?
Can and you? How about Buddha eye?
Yes.
Which is everywhere. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. There's different stages. You know. Sure. The Vimalakirti, the chapter called The Consolation of the Invalid, where he tells Manjushri how you console an invalid, and then he talks about personal selflessness and objective selflessness. You know, the selflessness of things and the selflessness of people. You know, that there's no essence in everything, no intrinsic reality in anything. Everything is only relative. You know? Buddha's scientific discovery of relativity, 2,500 years before Einstein. He discovered, you know, emptiness means discovery of relativity. It only means that all relative things have no non-relative component. They're empty of any relative essence, you know. That's wisdom eye. And we're going to do that next time, and we're going to read Heart Sutra, you know. You know, the Heart Sutra in the next class, you know. I'm sorry I didn't read today. Today we're just introducing this magical world of the Mahayana. But yes, that's correct. Wisdom eye sees through everything. You know, everything becomes transparent to wisdom eye. It sees reality as clear light of the void, what they call clear light of the void. But it's not really, it's not a bright light. It's a gray transparency like glass or a diamond. A diamond is transparent, it doesn't have a light. But light can shine through it. And everything, you know, wisdom eye sees like that.
So
but then Buddha eye, you can't even say how Buddha eye sees. It's inconceivable, inexpressible.
One time I was confused with the Dharma eyes and wisdom eyes.
Well,
so particularly these
levels.
Two was.
I think, I don't, you know, I'm sure different people have different way of explaining, but I think Dharma eye is the first level of where maybe you see things in conformity with reality. Mm-hmm. You see, the great thing about Buddha, why I always teach about Buddhist science. Buddha was also a scientist, not just a religious founder. He was not just a prophet. You know, he was a scientist. And the whole movement in Buddhism is based on his discovery of reality, actually. You know, nirvana is reality. It's not like some irrational thing somewhere else. It's reality itself, you know. And so it's based on realism. So, you know, we have the concept of taking refuge in Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha to become a Buddhist. But there's a very scientific way of understanding that. Because the real refuge, they always say, like Nagarjuna says, the Sangha, the great teachers, the real refuge is Dharma, actually. And Dharma doesn't just mean teaching, like words. Dharma means the reality that you teach. So Dharma means Nirvana itself. But Nirvana is not a separate thing, it is reality. So taking refuge in reality means being realistic. It's the opposite of that terrible slogan that we find in the West. Ignorance is bliss. I'd rather not know, then I can have a fantasy and I'll be happy. You know, I don't want to really know what reality is, which is based on an unfortunate idea that if you knew reality, you'd be frightened, that reality is scary, that reality is unpleasant, you know, which comes from authoritarian societies, you know. God creates the world, but it's bad, and everyone's going to go to hell unless God helps them or something like that. And I mean, monotheism has a little bit that tendency. Yeah. Mystics in monotheism, they see God as good, God as love, and this kind of thing. But the ordinary social system is based on you have to be scared of reality. And the Vedic world in India was like that too. The Vedic gods were very rough and tough, and you had to go to the Brahmin priest to offer hamburgers and pizzas to the gods so they wouldn't harm you. You were scared of them. You know, it was not a bhakti, God loves me like Krishna. That's a later development after Buddhism, actually. The early Indian religious thing was like scary God, you know. So Buddha's discovery is reality is freedom from suffering, which means bliss. Reality is happiness. That's what reality is. Suffering is unreality. That's the key. And that was a scientific discovery, a personal experiment, an experience of the Buddha, not a theory only. So when we take refuge in the Dharma, in its highest meaning, mm-hmm. we take refuge in the goodness of reality. And this is a complete shift psychologically. That's both in ancient time and in the West nowadays, which is more like ancient time. Although they think West is very modern, you have a Lexus, you have a computer, you have like all kind of thing. But in a way, also West is very backward. You know, it was colonialist and violent and military and wrecking the planet actually by being unrealistic right now. Some people in Texas, with Rex Tillerson of the Exxon Mobil, you know, too much oil and too much coal and too, no, bad and unrealistic, you know. It's not going to work out. So my point is, to be a Buddhist means to have faith that reality is basically good and that what the Buddha is pointing to is to not some complete irrational and far-fetched, you know, idea that everyone's going to be happy, but actually, by finding out what you truly are, what the world truly is, you know, Diamond Sutra, the reason they call it diamond, it isn't actually called Diamond Sutra. It's called Diamond Cutting Sutra, because diamond is the hardest thing. It can cut through any other thing. So it's the wisdom of reality is cut through ignorance. It's what it's a symbol of, cutting away ignorance, you know.
So in our normal life,
what?
In our normal life or education, we are told to increase our wisdom to know the reality, Dharma.
Yeah.
So, but in this five eyes definition, actually Buddha put the wisdom eye much higher than the Dharma eye.
Yeah.
The fourth one.
But Dharma eye there, I think they're saying Dharma eye there because there it's still on like a theoretical level. When it comes to wisdom eye, it's experiential level.
Okay.
And then when it's Buddha eye, it's beyond ordinary experience because there's no duality. In a way, the whole world is the eye, you know, because Buddha is the whole world. So it's like actually Emerson, the Western philosopher Emerson was, I think, an emanation, bodhisattva, for sure. And he had this amazing thing where he had the vision of an eye in the middle of nature that could look simultaneously in every direction. But and in a way, then where's the brain? You know, it's like we think of the eye as an instrument that looks at the outside and then takes a picture of it inside, right? So it's a separate thing from what it's looking at. But the Buddha eye is one with everything. It's part of what, there's no subject-object duality. And wisdom eye is getting very close to that, of course. But the deeper wisdom of Buddha is even deeper, where in a way there's no vision at all. They say Buddha eye is seized by not seeing. They have all kind of expression like that. So it's even deeper. You know? It's like when you know something so deeply that it's one with you, you become one, it's not separate from you. And you know, you're like a human CAT scan. You know, but all that is, you shouldn't think that that's not normal. All of that is normal. Everybody, like if you invented something, right, you're in IT, maybe you invented something once. But you know, when you had that flash of genius of inventing, it's because you somehow were there in the switch, you know. Steve Jobs was like in the transistor, you know. The founder of Intel was like somehow, and then they knew what it was, you know. And then they knew there was no limit how small it could be, like the thickness of one particle type of thing, you know. So all of human realism, the greater that reality, and now modern science is coming to where the world itself is a mirror of reality. Even though people are going at it in a way of out of greed and wanting to manipulate it, and they want to have an atom bomb, but the atom bomb was a big lesson for people, actually, on their subconscious, you know, on this planet. Atom bomb means my own atoms are completely unstable. I'm totally impermanent, you know. I could have a chain reaction, I would be pulverized, my body would be pulverized in a split second. So it's not something to be attached to in the same way. You know, it was a subliminal kind of release of the whole planet, that atom bomb, anybody who knew about it. And some crazy people like Mao, they said, they showed movies of somebody riding through an atom explosion without being injured. That's ridiculous, of course. So I think that Shakyamuni's Buddha world is bringing us into a place where reality itself is showing us in a mirror, in what's called the mirror wisdom, the true nature of things, you know. And we're actually going to get better. And the U.S. is going to have its first woman president, which is really good. Dalai Lama really likes that. Because, you know, he says women will tend to do violent response a little more hesitantly than the men, you know. I mean, that they're not perfect either, but they will tend to be less violent. You know, men will immediately, like, do something violent when there's a problem, you know.
He said,
In general, I mean, I'm not in present company excluded. People who listen to their wives will be a little better, men who listen. But somebody who, you know, there's a very bad joke about Donald Trump. And I really shouldn't tell it. But you know, he's very anti-migrant. He doesn't like migrants. But he's had 3 migrant wives, which shows you that there are some jobs Americans just won't do. I'm sorry, I apologize. So we need migrants. Donald Trump needed migrants. He wouldn't have managed.
So do you think that the...
I'm sorry, yes?
Do you think the Dharma eyes is to see the reality, to comprehend the reality that our human being can...
I know. But you see, Dharma has 11 meanings. Vasubandhu says 11 meanings. And it can mean words, like teaching, and it can also mean the reality that is taught beyond words. So I think when they use it with the eye, in the line of 5, you know, flesh eye, Dharma eye, wisdom eye, Buddha eye, I think there's one more in there, I forget what it...
Heaven eye.
Which one? Oh, divine eye, yeah, God, divine eye, that's right. So flesh eye, divine eye, Dharma eye, Buddha eye, I mean, Dharma eye, wisdom eye, Buddha eye, 5 eyes. So when they're there, they're using Dharma in terms, I think, of verbal Dharma. So it means like where you understand intellectually. And this is, people misunderstand this in Buddha, about Buddhism a lot. They think that Buddha didn't like intellect, that you just have to meditate and throw away your intelligence. That's totally wrong. Your meditation will get nowhere if you didn't first understand it conceptually with your intelligence. You know, there's 3 levels of wisdom, made of learning, made of critical reflection and then finally made a meditation, not just meditation. And so a Dharma eye is where you have some intellectual understanding of the nature of what you're looking at. And so you're trying to go beyond just being thinking of it as a self-centered thing, you know, an intrinsically real thing, an objective thing, intrinsically objective thing. You're beginning to realize it's a relative thing. You realize it's impermanent. You realize it's selflessness a little bit, to some extent. And then wisdom eye is where you have actually really experienced that and you kind of see through it. And then wisdom eye goes beyond Buddha. So Dharma could be used, you know, Dharma body. Buddha eye is Dharma body, same thing. Buddha eye. But Dharma body is everything. You know, that Buddha becomes everything. But one with Nirvana, you know. And sustain, and samsara is contained within Nirvana. That's great, that's from Buddha's point of view, you know. But you know, never mind. So that's very good. Thank you, everyone. So good night, everybody, and nice to see you. Thank you. Thank you, Patana.